gracias for everyone to come here, and that's pretty much the Spanish that I speak. So I'm sorry about that, but next time I come, hopefully I'll know a few more sentences. As introduction, I'm Nikhil Nanivadekar. I'm the project lead of Eclipse Collections. I'm a director at Bank of New York Mellon, and I'm a Java champion since last year, 2018, as well as I'm an Oracle Groundbreaker Ambassador. So that's how I know Enrique Chochos and Domingo. That's how essentially this meetup came into picture, that we are going to learn about Eclipse Collections. And also they said, put in some do-it-yourself collections as well. So I'll try to make a mix and match of these two. If I'm going fast at any time, please let me know, so I'll slow down, okay? If I'm going too slow, please let me know, I'll speed up. I know this content. I've been the project lead for Eclipse Collections for 3 years. I've been a contributor for about 4 years now. I've been doing this for many years. So I want this talk to be more directed to you, so that you can ask me questions. I'm happy to dive deep as you folks want. Okay. So, any questions so far? No. Good. Bueno. Another word. Okay, so what we are going to look at today? Today we are going to see what exactly is Eclipse Collections. We are going to see how exactly we ended up looking at the APIs and what was missing in the JDK, and we added it in Eclipse Collections. And then the importance to symmetry that we give, because, and you'll understand in a second why symmetry is important, then the most important thing is, how do we decide to evolve the API? Because, adding any sort of API, the support, the complexity, everything, that takes a lot of work, right? All of us know that. But there are strategies which we follow so that it makes it a bit easier for us. And then we'll go on with looking at the memory efficiency. We'll compare with the JDK hash set and the unified set of Eclipse Collections, and then we'll sort of end up, we'll end it with what's going to happen in the future. Okay? So very first thing, what is Eclipse Collections? Eclipse Collections is an open source Java collections framework. Okay? It is a supplement to the JDK collections framework. How many of you use the Eclipse IDE? Not many. How many of you use IntelliJ IDE? Okay, all right, all of us, exactly, thank you. Okay, the one disclaimer is this library has nothing to do with the Eclipse IDE, okay? It has, you don't have to use the Eclipse IDE to use this framework. I develop Eclipse Collections in IntelliJ IDE, okay? So, and I'm gonna show live demo, I'm gonna write live code, it's gonna be IntelliJ IDE, okay? So, don't be confused that you need to use the Eclipse IDE, because Eclipse Collections is a plugin for that. Each time I see that on Twitter, I'm like, oh boy, one more person. But please don't do that, okay? It is, the reason why it's called Eclipse Collections is because it's a collections framework which was migrated to the Eclipse Foundation in 2015. Previously, it was developed at Goldman Sachs and it was called as GS Collections, and then everything was done internally. So I used to work at Goldman Sachs until very recently, and that's where I started developing the framework. But essentially the problem there was, we were open source, but we were not truly open source. Now what that means is, it was free as a beer for you to consume it, right? But you could not contribute back. If you had any new contributions that you needed to put out, if you had any bug fixes, you could only request features, but you could never contribute code back, because everything was internal. And we were not used to doing open source. So with Eclipse Collections, we learned how to do open source, and we migrated it to the Eclipse Foundation. Now everything is on GitHub. Okay, and most recently, as recent as 2 weeks ago, the Java user group leader of Medellin Jug in Colombia, Hilmer Chuma, actually contributed the Spanish translation of our website. So that's in Spanish if you know folks want to take a photo and take a look at it. All of these slides are available online. It's on GitHub itself. So if you go to eclipse.org/collections and you know, if you just go to that, you'll get all the other languages as well. Okay, so moving on, again, if this is where all you have the information. So why did we even decide to, you know, develop this framework, right? This framework is not new. It's been worked on since 2004, 2005. Internally in Goldman, it was called as Caramel, like the previous slide mentioned. And when we open sourced in 2012, it was called GS Collections, moved it to the Eclipse Foundation. It was called as Eclipse Foundation. It was called as Eclipse Collections. The most important reason why we wanted Eclipse Collections to be, you know, a library, a Java library, was because the rich and fluent API was missing in the JDK, right? So in Java 8, all of us got lambdas, right? How many of you use lambdas? All of us, pretty much, right? Eclipse Collections was actually, the unit test of Eclipse Collections was actually used by one of the Java user groups. It was a London Java user group where they converted all our unit tests to Java 8, and they ended up testing the Lambda features, Lambda and method reference features, using Eclipse Collections. Don Raab, who is the creator of the framework, was in the JSR expert group as well. So essentially, what we developed internally actually helped the entire Java ecosystem. All right. Then memory efficient data structures. So if you look at our data structures, like if you compare the Eclipse Collections unified map to the JDK map, the memory footprint is about 1/3 of the memory footprint of the hash map. The hash set of Eclipse Collections, which is called as a unified set, the memory footprint is 1/6 of the JDK hash set. Now, every time you end up getting memory efficiency, you end up compromising on something. And so we are slightly less performant. I mean, when I say slightly, like really, really slightly, when we measure it on Java benchmarks, we are really slightly less performant. And that's because we don't cache the hash code. Because we don't cache the hash code, you have to compute the hash code for every single time. And that's the reason we are less performant. Okay, but essentially the way all of these data structures are implemented, they are highly memory efficient. And more than that, we have primitive specialization as well. Because in Java, you can only create data structures out of objects, correct? Until like Project Valhalla comes, you know, into fruition. We don't know when that's going to happen. Sometime in the future when we get value types. But essentially, as of this moment, if we want to create a collection of an int, not an integer, an int, a primitive int, we cannot do that in the JDK. However, in Eclipse Collections, we have primitive specialization. So we have list, set, bag, map, stack of all primitives. And map is even extended furthermore that it is object primitive map, primitive object map, because key values, and then primitive primitive map. Okay? So we have covered pretty much everything that was possible, except for a few other data structures, but it's no much more value add. The interop. Each of our collections, other than the primitive collections and the stack, extend JDK collections. So basically, our unified map, which is an implementation of our mutable map, extends Java's map. So anytime you're using the JDK map, it's a drop-in replacement to use a unified map. Same thing with a unified set. Like unified set is an implementation of a mutable set. Mutable set extends the JDK set. So anytime you see the JDK set, you can just, it's a drop-in replacement. Okay. So that's fairly straightforward. Immutability. In JDK, you don't have immutable data structures. You have unmodifiable now. Okay, so what's the difference between immutable and unmodifiable? Anyone? So the difference is unmodifiable throws at runtime. The API is still exposed. You have add, remove. This API is still exposed on unmodifiable. However, at runtime, it will throw an exception because it's unmodifiable. And immutable is where the API is not even exposed. you won't be able to do dot add on it, because you don't get add on that data structure. So it's, I mean, I'm giving a very simplistic explanation of immutability, but essentially that's what it is. Like, you don't have the API. And then in addition to that, like, there were missing types. Like, for example, interval stacks, bags, multi-maps, and bi-maps. Bag and multi-map, we are going to see towards the second half of the presentation, where I'll actually create the bag and multi-map with all of you. I'll go a little bit fast over there, so that, like, in the interest of time. But intervals, like, now with Java 8, we did get in-stream intervals, where you could go zero to some numbers, but they were not there before. As a stack, the JDK stack is actually, so how should a stack behave? It should be last in, first out, right? Or it should be first in, last out, however you want to look at it. The JDK stack extends vector, because of which it is not last in, first out. So what JDK says from JDK 6 is, instead of using a stack, you should use a deck, right? Our stack ends up implementing as if it was a real stack. You know, it is last in, first out, okay? So these are a few of the, you know, important reasons why. And we set out with this library. Any questions so far? Okay, all right. So Eclipse Collections today, this is a very simplistic way of, like, showing how Eclipse Collections is divided. But essentially, if you see on the right-hand side, you have the patterns. Because in terms of behavior, you have eager and lazy. In JDK, you only get lazy with streams, because streams are by default lazy, right? Then also you have serial and parallel. You can, the same collection can be converted from serial iteration to parallel iteration by just calling as parallel on it. Then the interface, readable, mutable. So readable is similar to unmodifiable. Readable, mutable, and immutable, okay? I've already mentioned that before. And then you have object and primitive containers. So that's the right side. That's sort of like, you know, showing the functional aspects, like what all things you're getting. On the left side is all the data structures that you're getting. So you get all list, set, map, multi-map, bag, stacks, etc., etc., okay, with Eclipse Collections. Now here comes the importance of symmetry. What we try to do is we try to make sure that all the API that is available on Eclipse Collections, wherever applicable, is distributed on every single data structure that Eclipse Collections has. So essentially, if we take select or if we take reject, all the data structures that are there in Eclipse Collections will get select and reject, okay? Whereas now you take put. Put is only applicable to map and multi-map, right? So it will only be there on map and multi-map. In addition to that, what we do is what we call is something as covariant overrides. So what covariant overrides mean is, if you are operating on a particular data structure, what makes sense from that data structure's perspective is what you get back. For example, if you call select on a list, you get back a list. You don't have to do collectors.toList. Okay? If you're doing a select on a set, you get back a set. Okay? Same thing about other specific. For example, on a multi-map, if you're doing group by unique keys, you get a map. Okay? So these are the covariant overrides that we give. Now, if you're doing, even within that, now let's say you're doing a select on a mutable set, okay? You get back a mutable set. If you're doing select on a unified set, you get back a unified set. So we are covariantly overriding the types. Okay? I hope this helps. All right. I'm not going to go much more in this, but I already explained everything in this slide. Okay? But this is just for reference, that how each of the API is available for each of the behavior. Right? And we have about 80 plus different iteration patterns on our most basic interface. So you get to benefit, like, all of this. Like, you get all that entire rich API for you at, like, literally no cost. So going to how do we essentially evolve the API? Because adding these 80 iteration patterns, it wasn't done in one day. It wasn't done in one release, right? It was essentially done according to the needs. For example, it's very easy and it's very low cost to add any API on a static utility. We have static utility like iterate, list iterate, set iterate, right? So anytime we are adding a new API, it goes on the static utility, okay? But it is difficult to add a new API in the concrete interface, because let's say I add a new API on rich iterable, it has to be implemented across the board on every single implementation until Java 8 came. With Java 8, we got default methods. So it became slightly of a lesser cost to implement an API, implement a new iteration pattern. However, because we want to do covariant overrides, it is still expensive to add any new API, okay? For example, adding any new data type which is there, like in between someone wanted us to add I think it was like a scapegoat tree or something like that. Like they wanted us to add a new, or it was a table. Yeah, they wanted us to add a table similar to Guava, which is a valid use case. But adding a new data structure is always expensive, right? So we always balance cost to the functionality that we'll give. Okay. Any questions so far? Am I going too fast or too slow? Good? Okay. All right, I had alluded to the memory efficiency aspects of it. Come on in. Memory efficiency aspects of the framework. So if you look at the memory efficiency of set, you will see the JDK hash set and the unified set of Eclipse collections, like it's about 6 times the memory. So at that time, I mean, you have to also consider that, fine, if you're getting upfront performance, because how many of you know how JDK has implemented the hash set? Okay, for most of you said no. Okay, the way JDK has implemented the hash set is it's backed up by a hash map. It's backed up by a hash map where the value is always null. It's a null object. It's not a null object, it's an empty object, okay? Because they get to reuse the same, essentially, the characteristics are the same, right? A set is nothing but a map without the value, right? However, in Eclipse collections, we say no, a set has to be a set. So the Eclipse collection set, as well as the unified map, both of them are backed up by a flattened array. It's an array-based data structure, which will surprise many folks, but essentially, and I've given a talk about that, like under the hood of, like, you know, Eclipse collections, and I have other blogs as well, and I'll send it over to Enrique and Domingo about how the implementation of HashMap and HashSet is in Eclipse collections. Essentially, it's a flattened array. So whenever it's a HashMap, we do key value, we alternate that. If there's a hash collision, we just put in a node object, and then we end up doing key value in its linked list. Okay, it's not a linked list, but similar to a linked list. In case of a set, it is always a set. There are no key value, there are just elements. And that's why we end up saving so much memory. Okay, also we don't cache the hash code. Because we don't cache the hash, we end up saving memory there. Okay. And now, if you look at the memory efficiency between the primitives, previously I said that, like, in the JDK, till Project Walhalla goes into, you know, production, you cannot create an array list of int. You have to box those int to integers, right? So that's the difference. I mean, if you are storing 1 million ints, technically, it should only take whatever space that 1 million ints will take, right? And a little bit more space for the header as well as padding, et cetera, for every single cell. But in case of the JDK, because every object is boxed, it's the object is getting stored, you end up, wasting a lot of memory. Okay? Any questions on this? Yes.
I think the memory is performing introduce the sense of the difference of I think your connection will maybe use we have to use this sense.
I didn't quite follow the question. Yeah. Sorry.
I think the user memories depend and use the conditional if or the conditional form.
There is nothing really conditional if or conditional. But the memory efficient, like the basic way in which the Java hash set is implemented, it's essentially a hash map, right? And the hash map keeps on storing the hashes. It is implemented as an entry object, whereas the way the Eclipse Collections hash set is implemented, it's a flattened array. So we are only storing the objects in an array. So that's why it does not, I mean, it might differ how much memory you're saving depending on the object that it is in every set, but underlying fact is that the hash set will take more memory than the unified set. I hope that helps. You have any more questions? I'm fine to go deep in this. Okay. So essentially, how did we get here, right? Like, because if you see, evolving this entire library was not like it has been under, I won't say under development, it has been under maturity for the last 14 years, right? So most of the things were Smalltalk influence. The creator of the framework, Don Rab, he was a previous Smalltalk developer, and he brought pretty much most concepts from Smalltalk, especially the naming as well as the factory methods. Because if you'll see on the next page, designing the names of the APIs is difficult, right? What are the two most difficult things in software programming? Naming an off by one, right? Right? So until and unless you get the off by one, the way I tell this joke is like, there is only one most difficult thing in software programming. One is naming, and the second one is off by one. Right? So it's essentially that. But it's always difficult to name. So how do we decide naming is, one, we try to keep it consistent. And I just don't go and write a new API and commit it. Like, in order for us to figure out what name is going to be there, there's like extensive debate which happens on GitHub, and everything is in open. We are not like discussing, offline or anything. Everything is open, where like people are saying, hey, it doesn't make sense. Like, this might mean this, this might mean that. However, at the same time, we can't make everybody happy. So some people say that, hey, we are not going to, these Eclipse Collections names are way too difficult for us to understand. We understand filter. But essentially, filter is nothing but select in Eclipse Collections, right? Reject, which JDK does not have, is essentially a negation of the filter, right? Now, collect is map. And most people will say, oh, collect is but like where you pass in a collector. No, in Eclipse Collections, collect is essentially a transform. You're going from one object to another object, okay? And so on and so forth. But if you look something interesting, if you look at detect if none, detect optional, in order to achieve the exact same pattern from the JDK, you have to do so much work, right? But in Eclipse Collections, that API is already written for you. Okay, so these are a few things, and the way the names came into picture, select, detect, reject, collect, were from Smalltalk. And the reason why it came from Smalltalk is because Smalltalk developers ended up having these APIs so that they were easy to remember. They did not have modern IDEs like IntelliJ IDEA, where you press a dot and then you like scroll. How many of us do that? When you don't know what you need on a particular object, right? Everybody does that. You press a dot, and then like you're going down and seeing, hey, does this do that? Like, oh, let me check the Java doc, right? Or let me Google what exactly is going on with this, correct? It's exactly the same thing. So what's going to happen in the future? The most important thing is the library needs, like right now we support Eclipse Collections 9.0 plus supports JDK 9 plus. And we are a part of the early adopters program. So what that means is whenever a new early access version is released by, in OpenJDK, we get an email and I end up updating the build on Travis, and everything is again open source. You can go to GitHub and look at that. And our project starts building with these new binaries, which are still in early access mode. And if there are any bugs, and I've actually raised a couple of Java compiler bugs because we were a part of the early adopters program. Like there are sometimes it ends up happening that the build slows down. Like for example, the Java 11 build will run in 9 minutes, but the Java 13 build is taking 15 minutes, right? So we end up reporting these issues, and then and essentially the library is used to help improve the JDK. So Eclipse Collections 9.0 plus up till plus supports JDK 9 plus, okay? However, the library is not modularized. What that means is if tomorrow in your project you only want to add the list module, you can't do that. If you only want to add the primitive module, you can't do that, right? You end up getting the whole library. And that is something that is going to take a lot of work, right? Because we have to pretty much dissect the entire library. Then we have to end up figuring out how exactly we'll chunk it, what is most logical, which are the modules that we would want to distribute, right? And essentially then do the modularization. It's like easily a 6 month worth of work. So unless I stop traveling to CDMX and enjoying food and focusing on modularization, or someone else does it, you know, that might not happen. We want to improve symmetry. Sometimes I feel that our primitive data structures need a bit more love, because first thing that we go to is the object side. We implement the object side, but we forget about primitives. So nowadays, the new thing that we have started is like anytime we see a new API that someone is contributing, we see, say, okay, that's fine, but raise an issue for primitive side. Okay, developing on the primitive side is not that straightforward. We code generate all our primitive implementations. So we just have template files, and then at build time, all the classes are generated, and then the jar is created. So you have to edit the template file, and our unit tests are templatized, our interfaces are templatized, our implementations are templatized. So essentially, you're writing code only once. But writing that takes a little bit of time. we already are pretty very well integrated with Java. However, there are a few, most likely when Project Valhalla comes into fruition, we'll be able to do much more work with interop. And then this is already done, where we are on the Eclipse build train. So none of you raised the hand for using Eclipse IDE, so I don't have to explain this. Thanks a lot. Okay. with that, that's the end of my first part of presentation. If I have not bored you a lot, then I will go to actually implementing bags and multimaps. So, yes.
Are you embracing like the use of Node as part of your API design? I am asking you this because I saw that you produce like your detect method returns Node.
Yes.
If you don't find the element.
Yes.
So, yeah, actually that's a question. If you're embracing like Node.
No, we are not replacing the null, because there is existing production code which depends on null. So if we end up returning an optional, it will be more of an intrusive change. So what we decided was we introduced detect optional, which essentially returns an optional. So all the folks, because this library, believe it or not, is used by applications who are still on Java 7. Especially in the embedded space, because those folks don't have enough support to actually get to Java 8. Now, by using the library, what they're achieving is they get to play with the functional style of programming while still being on Java 7, right? With the library. So that's what they're doing. So essentially, if we end up returning for all detects the optional, it will cause them to break. So that's why there is detect optional. Now, again, if they're still on Java 7, that will throw compiler error. I understand that. But eventually, when those libraries upgrade to Java 8, we don't want them to be in a situation, or those applications upgrade to Java 8, we don't want the upgrade to be difficult, right? Because it will be much more intrusive to do that. I literally just published a blog about upgrading dependencies. It was all about this, right? Like, we want to make it as easy for our users as possible. So there's detect optional. Wherever optionals were possible, we have actually introduced them. And if we are missing any, feel free to raise an issue or a pull request, and we'll review and we'll accept it. Okay, it's all open source. So any other questions? No? Do folks want a 5-minute break, or you want me to go continue into DIY collection? I'm fine with both. Yeah, go on. Okay. They're like, don't stop, keep on talking. Okay. I didn't know you guys like my voice so much. I mean, okay. Before I go into DIY collections, I'll just show it live about the iteration patterns and how fluent the API is. Can everybody read the font? Do you want me to switch to dark mode? Because everybody's, I think, either you, like, I can see everyone is like awake now. That's really good. All right. So let's say when you want to do a transformation, right? Like when you want to go from an object, let's say person, into another object, which is string, what you need to do is, let's say people. Now in the JDK, you would use dot stream, dot map, and then dot collect, right? With Eclipse Collections, you can just do person dot get first name. And the beauty of IntelliJ is it actually understands that this is what you might need. So if you see, all I did was, I just did a dot, and the first thing that it showed up was collect, right? Because IntelliJ understands that. And then the next thing it was person.get first name, right? So this was one API. The second one that I want to show, and by the way, this is coming from the kata. So again, this is open source. If you go to the Eclipse Collections kata, you will get all of these examples. And I'm just solving them right now to show, to give you a glimpse of the library, okay? The next thing that I want to show is, let's say, in our domain, it's basically person and pet. So each person object has pet or does not have pet, right? Now, the pet can be of different types, cats, dogs, hamster, et cetera, right? So if we want to get all the people, right, or all the person objects who essentially have cats, then we do want to use the select pattern, correct? Now in the select pattern, you want to say, let's say person, right? And person dot has pet, pet type dot cat, correct? Now let me just indent it a little bit so that we can read. Now if you see here, I'm using a lambda, right? Everybody can see a lambda. With the JDK, if you're doing this, you will still do a dot select and you'll still have to use a lambda, correct? But what if I don't want to use a lambda? Because I'm a fan of method references, okay? Like, I love to use method references wherever I can. So with Eclipse Collections, we have something called as the with pattern, okay? And this existed even before the lambdas, okay? So with the with pattern, what we can do is, this changes into something like this. Basically, we parameterize whatever we are trying to send inside the lambda. Okay? So can you see? I'm going to run the test again just to show that it still works. And now you will see that there is actually a warning here or a hint here. IntelliJ understands that you can replace it with a method reference. Right? So it's just has pet. And we didn't know that. Like that this was just serendipity that like it worked like that. But the with pattern was already existing before Java 8. And it's because when you're passing in this parameter, now this is an enum, so you know it's pretty much constant time and constant memory. But let's say you're computing something on the go. Now if it is inside that lambda, you'll compute it every single time. Right? So, what if you don't want to compute it every single time? You want to send it in as a parameter, right? So that's why we had the width pattern. Okay. Now, last but not the least, if I want to do a negation, right? In JDK, what we'll do, we'll do it JDK style first. We'll say people without cats, and I'm going to do the width pattern. Oh, sorry, I can't do the width pattern with that. But I'll do person, and person dot has pet, pet type dot cat, right? And there'll be a not, correct? Right? But the opposite of select in Eclipse Collections is essentially reject, right? Now remember symmetric sympathy before. If there is a reject, there will be a reject with, right? So now we'll have reject with, and we'll have person has pet, pet type dot cat, okay? And the importance of having a reject versus a negated select is when you're doing code reviews or when you're maintaining code, if by mistake you missed that exclamation sign while reading, you're avoiding bugs, okay? All right, any more questions? No, perfect. All right, now we are gonna go next into DIY collections. And this is a completely hands-on talk. So I don't have any slides. I write the slides as I present, okay? So any questions on Eclipse Collections part of it before I go to DIY collections? All right, normally I don't do the two talks back to back, that's why, but I'll introduce myself again because, well, why not? So I'm Nikhil Nanivadekar. I'm the project lead of Eclipse Collections. My Twitter handle is at Nikhil Nanivade. The only reason why it does not have my full last name is because Twitter did not allow it. And there are about 6 million Nikhils in this world. So that was the way for me to differentiate myself by, you know, having it till Nanivade. Okay. I promise you, I tried putting the whole name in. It doesn't fit. And some of my friends say that's actually helpful because they are like, we have to like keep on typing and searching for you. So that's it. The entire repo is available on GitHub. So that's it's under my personal repo. It's called as DIY Collections. GitHub does allow me to use my full name, and I used it. Okay. So this is DIY Collections. Now we heard a lot about Eclipse Collection in the first 45 minutes of the talk. But what exactly are collections? Can anybody say what are can anybody tell me what are collections? All of us use it every day, right? Someone else, what are collections?
Data structures to keep objects or data.
Yeah, they are data structures to keep objects or data. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Now, there are three most important data structures as Java developers that we use pretty much on a regular basis, right? First one is list, right? But what is a list? It is an ordered, should I say list? I would say it's an ordered collection of elements, right? Here, elements, if I can spell it, elements. Here, the order is most important, right? The whole semantic of the list is that the insertion order is maintained, okay? The next one is a set. Now, what is a set? So, it is a collection which retains only unique elements, right? And which is the third and the last, our favorite one, the map. The moment anybody learns about a map, what do you do? Anywhere you can use it, you're like, all you can see is just map, right? So like the interesting thing is, like, I'm a mechanical engineer. I did not learn computer science. Okay, like I have a bachelor's and a master's degree in mechanical engineering with specialization in robotics. The first day I wrote Hello World in Java was 3rd July 2012, because 2nd July 2012 was my first day at my, you know, then employer, right? And then about 3 or 4 days later, I learned about maps, and I was like, oh my God, this data structure is going to solve everything, Like, literally, like, I don't need any other data structure, right? Because I'm like, oh, list, yeah, they're like, but map, oh my God, that is like the best thing that could ever happen in the world of data structures, right? And trust me, that's how everybody feels, so thank you. Each time I present this, I ask this question, and it's like a self-attestation that, hey, I wasn't that bad of a person to think, or I wasn't that dumb at that time to know that, like, hey, maps solve everything, right? But essentially, map, it is a collection which maintains the relationship between keys and values, right? That's it. That's pretty much straightforward. Now, what I'm going to say is, I'm going to ask you a question. Are these three data structures enough? No. Yes. Yeah, so all these three are types of collections. Sorry? Oh, binary tree. So generally a binary tree is a collection, but it is a sorted collection. You see what I'm saying? Because there are two different things, right? Ordering and sorting. So for example, ordering means the way you insert it is the way they are ordered. That order is maintained. Whereas sorting is different, because in sorting, you're giving a comparator, right? Or let's say you're not giving a comparator, it is a comparable object. So anytime you insert something, it gets sorted and it gets put in its right place. So ordered is different than sorted. But however, binary tree is a type of collection, and you never get just a binary tree, you get a binary tree set, right? That's the reason why you have list, set and map as the important collections. Now people will argue that, hey, map is not a collection. No, map is a collection, okay? It's our favorite collection, it's my favorite collection, so we are going to keep it like that, okay? But anyways, are these three enough? The answer is not really, right? So this talk was actually written. The concept of this talk was actually written while we were at Oracle Code 1 last year, 2018. And Stuart Marks, who is one of the architects of the JDK collections framework, and we were discussing about bags, okay? So today we are going to learn about two new data structures called as bags and multimaps. Okay, a small trailer, a bag is nothing different than your shopping bag or a shopping cart, where you have an element and a quantity. A multi-map is nothing different than a multi-valued collection. Okay, we are going to create both of these collections, and I'm going to show you the different safety nets that you have to add in order to make these collections actually useful. And you get these in Eclipse collections already. So these are already available, and you can use them without having to rewrite the same code over and over and over again and introduce bugs, okay? So just in order to tell you, I presented this talk at JPoint Russia, where I got a lot of critical feedback. So I decided to rewrite it. So I rewrote the talk. But then there's always the day before Oracle Code 1, there's a Java Champions briefing. And one of the other Java champions, Jose Pumard, was actually replying on Twitter for some of the iteration patterns that Don Raab had posted. And that led to both he and me, both Jose and I, contributing over Twitter. And that's how I again rewrote the talk. So this is the third time I've rewritten the talk. And essentially, we called it jet lag driven development. Okay, because he's from Paris, and he was totally jet lagged while in San Francisco, and I now live in Houston, and San Francisco is 2 hours behind. So technically, both of us were a little bit jet lagged, so we decided to write some code on Twitter, right? And this example comes from his gist. So if you look at, test string. So the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. It's essentially a string which contains all 26 letters of the alphabet, right? But now, what if I want to figure out how many times is each letter of the alphabet in this particular sentence? All I have to do is group it by, right? And then I have to count it. So in order to do it in the JDK, what you have to do is you have to get the characters, you have to get all the chars, If it's a letter, then I want to filter it. I want to select it. Then after that, I want to actually map it to a string, because that the key of the map is a string. And then I want to group it by each string. And every time I get an element, I want to increment the count, right? So fairly straightforward. Essentially, I have a map, and every alphabet has a number associated with it, and the number is the count. Okay, straightforward, pretty simple code, right? But if you see here, the map.size gives 26, which is essentially the size of the map. But now, what if I want to find the size of the total, the total size, right? I have to do a little bit of more stream jugglery, right? I have to first get the values, then I have to map each of the value to a long, and then I have to sum it, okay? So if I run this test, it passes. If I run this test, it passes. However, it is not so straightforward to do something which we do on a daily basis, right? Now let's put it in a practical example. Let's say you go to, you know, a grocery store, and you decide to buy apples, bananas, oranges, right? Now, if it is a list, each time you buy the apple, right? You take the apple, you put it in, take the apple, you put it in. Then suddenly you realize, oh, I have to take a banana, right? You put the banana, then you have another apple, right? So it's completely unsorted, right? But it is ordered, right? And then each time you want to count the number of apples, because now people will say, hey, why don't you use a set? Because I can always have more than one apple, right? So I need to have duplicates, but because they are duplicates, they're not essentially ordered. They're not essentially one after the other, right? So they'll say, oh, why don't you create a map? Yes, I will create a map, but it's difficult to create a map, right? So essentially, going back to me creating slides on the fly, essentially what we want is a data structure, which is a mix, okay? A mix of all these three data structures together. So a mix of all the three data structures together. Now, why is that, right? Okay, it is a list because anyone? Because it allows. I'm literally typing, folks. Come on, read it. It allows duplicates. Okay, it is a set because it allows, no, it doesn't allow anything. It is hashed, okay? And the reason, and because it is hashed, it allows you to have your interesting elements right one after the other, okay? And then lastly, it is a map because it is implemented as a map of element, comma, count, okay? So you got all these three data structures together. Does that make sense? Now let's go ahead. Yes, no, a little bit. Okay, so, yes. Is that better? Cool. So object and integer, right? And does that also answer your question? I thought you had a question. Oh, okay. All right. So now let's actually go ahead and implement this back, right? Now, if you look at it, I'm a fan of test-driven development, and the best way to do it is have failing tests, right? We'll go on fixing these tests one at a time, okay? So the very first one is actually creating the back. We have three strings, apple, banana, and orange, right? And I want to create a bag of apple, but okay, so by the end of this talk, I'm going to be like 2 beers down, so barely able to type, okay? So let me quickly finish this. So you have a new bag, apple, banana, orange, and apple, right? So what should we expect, right? If we get the number of times bag, number of times apple is, it's 2, right? Banana is 1, orange is 1, right? Fairly straightforward requirement, right? This is the requirement that we are trying to build a collection to satisfy, right? So let's actually build it. Now, new bag, if you see here, it says to do implement a constructor, right? So to begin with, we already discussed that it's going to be backed by a map of object and integer. and I'll call it a backing map. And I would have used Eclipse Collections, but I decided I'm going to stick to my basics and then show that, like, hey, it's difficult to do it with just the JDK. So use Eclipse Collections. But anyway, this is not advertisement, but private int size, okay, because we always need size. Generally, the rule is that your size should be O1. The call to size should be O1, except for a few exceptions, but we'll not get in there. All right, so all we need to implement this constructor. Now, this constructor is essentially, we'll iterate over these elements, right, and we'll take the backing map, okay. Now, starting with JDK 8, the JDK hash map got a few cool APIs. One of them is this, called as merge. Okay, what merge does, it takes the existing value of the if there is a value available, it takes the existing value and then it merges with the new value that you give. So in this case, I want to take the element. Okay, and the value that I'm going to give is, each time I see that element, I want it to increment by 1, right? So I want to give 1, okay? We are going to see another example where I don't use 1, okay? And then essentially I want what they call it as a remapping function. So you want to change the value, right, of the existing value which is there, right? So what they do is they say existing, comma new, comma new, and all you have to do is you say existing plus new value, right? That is one option, okay? The other option which I normally like to do is just say 1 here, okay? Because it's not going to make any difference. It's 1, it's a constant, right? And then we have to do this dot size plus plus, right? We always have to increment the size. Now, since I wrote the test, I know that there are many more other, you know, implementations that I have to do. So let's just quickly fix them, okay? So the size, we want to return this dot size. That is fairly straightforward. Size distinct in this case is going to be this dot backing map dot size. Now, do you see the difference between these two? The first size is incremented each time the element is added. The size distinct is just the size of the map, which is essentially just the size of the keys. Okay. Now, the occurrences which is there, this is interesting because essentially now we want to know how many times a particular element is there, right? So in this case, it is just as simple as we say element get or default. So if that is not there, what should be the default?
Zero,
exactly. There you go. I think that's it. Let's see if the test pass. If not, something else is missing. All right, the test passes. Any questions while creating the map, returning the size, returning the occurrences? Now, if you see here, the name of the API was get occurrences. It wasn't just get, okay? There is a specific reason for it, because we are returning occurrences. It is trying to make it more fluent, readable, and maintainable, right? Because if you just do a get, a map, of course, has a get, right? Anyone can just do this dot map dot, you know, get or default, right? But at the end of the day, you want to make it easier for the users to understand what is it doing. That's the reason why we call it get occurrences. Okay. Now, similar to get occurrences, you will have add occurrences, because once you're done creating the bag, let's say, like, for example, I get called and said, hey, instead of 4 apples, you have to bring 6 apples, right? I need to go and add 2 more apples, right? At that time, you don't want to create a whole new bag of apples, just of 2 apples, right? So essentially, we want to mutate it. In this case, we want to say add occurrences, right? Now, before we do that, I'm going to quickly implement add occurrence, because this is something which I have observed. Like, if you see a normal, a general pattern that will be observed, like, for example, you only want to add 1, right? You can, of course, do add occurrences, comma 1, right? You can pass in number 1. But instead of that, you can make it easier for the user and just expose that as an API. So this will just be, and as the library, you know, writer, as the developer, you can, of course, delegate it, right? And you know what is the other name of delegation pattern? Make it someone else's problem. And if you have not realized this, like most of the times what we do is, yeah, we'll just delegate it to the implementation, right? Essentially, what we're doing is we're making it someone else's problem, okay? So now, in this case, I'm making it the problem of add occurrences. Now, the way we want to add occurrences is fairly interesting, right? We have two options. What if a user calls add occurrences on an object which does not exist? What should happen? It should throw, or it should add. Exactly, it should add and it should increment. Exactly. So now, basically, this is similar to us using merge, right? But in this case, if you folks remember, up top here, I did a plus one, right? I did not use the existing value. However, in this case, I am using this value, which is E. Okay? So now what will happen is, it will see. Now, the property of the merge API of the JDK, again, I'm making it someone else's problem, if you folks didn't realize. I'm making this JDK's problem to implement the merge pattern correctly. Right? What the merge pattern says is, if it doesn't exist, it will create it and give it to you. Right? So the existing value comes as zero. Okay? Do you folks follow? And there are tests actually to affirm that. Okay? And then, I have to increase the size, right? But the size, because the size of the map, the distinct size might remain the same, but the actual total size might be different, right? So that was add occurrences. So let me go and rerun this test. Okay, it passed. Alright? Any questions on add occurrences so far? And if you didn't believe, like, see the strawberry, that's a new element which was added. Okay? And there is a test also for strawberry. So alright, the next one is remove. Now, how many of you think that adding is easier than removing, or removing is easier than adding? So is adding easier? Only one person. Is removing easier? So you folks think nothing is easier? That's good. So all problems are difficult. That's perfect. All right. So all right. The interesting thing about remove, so the interesting thing about add was, you just have to always insert the element, right? When it comes to remove, there is always a problem, okay? And let's see that. What could be the problem? Well, if there's no element, you don't do anything, right? Okay, so essentially, sorry. Again, I have to make it someone else's problem, right? Remove occurrence. Okay. So, all right. So, by the way, I'm not like really fast at typing, but I'm really good at doing live templating. How many of you who use IntelliJ know live templates? Okay, only one person. So, essentially, live templates are a boon to all the people who do live development talks, live coding talks. Because with live templates, what I can essentially do is, I can code up this entire thing, make sure the tests pass, okay? And when I'm always pressed for time, I can just have IntelliJ replace whatever I'm doing, you know, by just typing keywords and hitting enter or tab, okay? So this entire code. So if you have never used live templates, make sure you use it. Because I use it in my everyday dev job, and there are things that like I use over and over again. They are all live templated, so I just type like 4 or 5 keystrokes and they just show up. And like sometimes it's like just magic, you know, like right now. Right. So essentially, what we are going to do is, we are going to say that if I want to remove occurrences, I'm going to say, I can say compute if present. So that solves the problem of it being absent. Okay. So I'm going to reduce the count by the number of occurrences, right? And if the count is not null, then I'm going to reduce the size, right? And if the count is less than zero, because let's say I like if I have only 2 apples and someone asks me to remove 4, I can't remove 4, right? I can only remove 2. So I'm going to bottom it out at zero. And if they are zero, then I'm going to simply remove the element because it doesn't make sense to have zero, because we have another API which says get occurrences, which defaults to zero. Right? Now you see how everything is falling in place. Okay? However, I mean, I'll run this test. Are all the... Sorry? This is why there are live templates, by the way. So, all right, that test passed. But again, like while I was developing this talk, I realized, hey, I was missing another test case. So I added another test case. And the test case essentially was, in order to remove occurrences, once something is already removed, it should still work, correct? But what if I remove it to so much level that the size becomes zero? You have to handle that, right? My first implementation wasn't handling that. So I decided, all right, let's try to make it a little bit easy. And now, bag remove occurrences fixed. If you see here, essentially all it is doing is it does a get. Okay, it gets the existing count and there it floors it. Okay, so this is different than using compute if present. Okay, so sometimes going back to the basics is always good. Okay, so let me rerun this test and see. And the next two tests are for each with occurrences and for each. So I'm just going to quickly implement it here while we are here, and then we can rerun the whole thing. So for each with occurrences is similar to just using for each on the map. So I'm just going to say backing map and pass in a by consumer. Okay, and it's a void, so it doesn't return anything. Now for each is a little bit interesting, because the contract of for each means that it has to iterate over every single element. Okay, because it has to iterate over every single element, what do you have to do? You need to have a nested for loop, okay? And what that means is you say this dot backing map, right? Now, when you say for each, you get the key and the element, correct? So here you will get the element and the count. Sorry, not the key and the element and the count. Now, the moment you get the count, essentially this consumer has to be applied to every single element number of times the count. Okay, does that make sense? So in order to do that, what you do is for int I equal to 0, how many times have we written this? I less than count, I plus plus, and then we say consumer dot accept element. Okay, make sense? And I have other tests for it, but I'm just going to now run the whole back test here. All right, it worked. Okay, but this was, again, I just implemented 3 or 4 iteration patterns in front of you, right? If you want more, you can of course add more, but each time you add more complexity, you add more support. Okay, and again, think about it, right? Like, if, let's say, each one of us had to do a bag implementation at our work, there will be how many? Like, how many people are there? About 50 or 30 or? Like, yeah, those many implementations of bag will be present, right? So that's the reason why you use bag from frameworks. Now, Apache Commons Collections has bag as well as multi-set, because a bag is also called as a multi-set. The reason why it's called as a multi-set is because it allows multiple elements. It allows duplicates, but it's like a set. Okay, set containing multiple elements. Okay. Guava calls it a multi-set. Okay. In Eclipse Collections, we call it a bag. So you can use, like, I will of course say use Eclipse Collections. And if you have not gone to github.com/eclipse/eclipse collections, make sure you star the repo. If you go there, show your support, you know. Any questions on bag? No? we'll quickly, like in the next 10 minutes, we'll implement multi-map, okay? How many of you have an idea of what a multi-map is? Anyone? No? Okay. So, multi-map, it is a map, of course, it is a map which has a key but multiple values. Okay? Values. So, essentially, it is a key which has, it is a map which has a value collection. Okay? So, this is how it is. K, collection V. Okay? Now, even though it's written that way, there are a few assumptions that folks make while building multi-maps. The very first assumption is that if the value collection is empty, the key should not exist. Okay? So, if the value collection is empty for a key, then the key should not exist in the multi-map. Okay? Now, why is that? The reason for that is another way of looking at a multi-map is essentially it being a collection of key value pairs. Okay? Now, because you want to look at it as a key value pairs, if you cannot have a key with a no value, and that's the reason why they don't keep it. Okay? So that's one way. Second, and because you won't have a key without a value collection, your for each as well as your null safety changes. Because now you will never have to do a check whether something is null. Okay? Does that make sense? However, if a key does not have, if a key does not exist, the return should always be an empty collection. Okay? So you're not storing the key, but you're returning an empty collection. Okay? Now, all of us know that whenever we are dealing with collections, we have to be a slightly, you know, careful. Because you can, the moment you get the reference to that collection, you can mutate it. Right? So the other thing is, the value collection should be non-modifiable when returned as a part of get. Okay? With me so far? Now, in today's case, I'm not going to go into the unmodifiable aspect of it. I just wanted to let everybody know that this is some of the nuances, the semantics that you have to take care of. Okay? Now, when I say that the it's going to be a collection of values, which collections can it be? Exactly. So, it will be a map of key, comma, list of values. Okay? It will be a map of key, comma, set of values. And then when it is Eclipse Collections, since we have bag as well, so you can have a map of key and a bag of values. Okay? In today's case, we are only going to implement list multimap and a set multimap. Okay? Now, what should happen if you put the same element twice? Okay? What if you put the same key and value twice? Okay, let's say you do multimap dot put, you know, so how many ones should be there in the value? Only one? Exactly. It depends, right? Like any scientific answer, it depends. Okay? Essentially, it depends on the backing value collection. Okay? If it is a list, there should be two. If it is a set, there should only be one. Okay? Now, with all of this knowledge, we are going to go ahead and implement a multi-map. right? Like I said before, I like test-driven development. So if all of these failing tests are already written for us, and the first thing that we want to do is create this multimap. Okay. While creating the multimap, this test always passes because all I'm checking is whether something is null or not, right? Each time an object is created, it is not null, right? Because I'm creating it newly, right? However, when I start to put objects in the map, I get assertion errors and all that stuff because, hey, it is not yet constructed. So let me go quickly construct the multimap. Now, what I've done here essentially is this multimap is extended by a list multimap and by a set multimap. Okay? The only difference is in this method called as getEmptyBackingCollection. A set returns a hash set, a list returns an array list. Okay? With that said, it makes it easier for me to put the common code in only one, you know, sort of abstract class called as multimap. Okay, so let's go ahead and start constructing this multimap. So whenever we are doing a get, so if you see here this backing map, it's just a new hash map, right? I did not want to have another constructor on list multimap for the sake of this presentation, but if you look at Eclipse Collections or Guava or Apache, you will see that Apache Commons Collections, you will see that there are actually constructors which create the specific list multimap. In today's talk, we are going to assume that, you know, the constructor always just returns you that multimap, and the way you end up populating is by doing put. Okay? So before we put, we need to be able to get it. So here, the get is going to be this dot backing multimap dot get or default key, comma, this dot get empty backing collection. Now this is interesting because I always return the empty backing collection, so you always keep on getting new. We can optimize it by, you know, creating a static copy or something like that, which is unmodifiable. Okay. The next one is creating the put. The put is a little bit interesting, right? Essentially, what you want to do is, if a particular key doesn't exist, you need to create an empty collection and then you need to put it, right? So it's nothing but doing a get. If it is not null, sorry, if it is null, you want to replace it with an empty backing collection, put it, and then because we already have the reference of the values, you just end up putting in that particular value. Okay? With me so far? Any question? Okay. In terms of put all makes it a little bit interesting because the values are an iterable. Okay? And an iterable can only be iterated by using an iterator. Okay? If the iterable is actually a collection, then of course you can use for each and all those other things. But at the end of the day, if you are having the basic iterable, you always need the iterator. Right? So the multimap put all becomes a little bit interesting. It's again similar to the put, right? Where you are instantiating it with an empty backing collection. But in addition to that, you have to have a for loop on those iterable items. Okay? With me so far? Good. Now let me run the next test. Actually, I'm going to run all the tests and let's see which ones fail. Then we'll fix those. Okay, so remove failed. So let's implement remove. Okay, so remove all is interesting, right? Because when you're removing a particular key, you don't care about the values, right? So you can just do this dot backing map dot remove key. So this is fairly straightforward. So this was easy, but removing the backing collection, again, if you remember before, what I had said before, if you remove and the value collection is empty, you need to remove the key as well. So it involves another level of check. So essentially in multimap.remove, what you have to do here is you end up getting the backing collection, correct? So get or default. Now if the default collection is empty, right, you don't need to do anything and you return a false because you can't remove anything. However, if it is not empty, and again, you remember I had said before that in the select you always miss the not. So I saw a few few folks say that, like, why is he talking about empty? There's a not there. Like, well, yes, I was coming to that. So the not empty part of it, which is there, is makes it what that's what makes it a bit more interesting, where you want to remove the value, right? Because from the existing, you want to remove that one particular value. But now, if you have removed something, it's not essential that there is something for it to remove. At that time, from the collection, you get a false, right, in that remove. So let's say you have removed and the existing has now become empty because this was the last element. You also need to remove the key, right? Again, that's the reason why it adds a little bit more complexity. Now, if you look at it, it's not that complicated piece of code that all of us cannot write. However, the problem is that all of us end up, like, we will end up writing the same exact code over and over again. So if we have these libraries already available, you just use it, or you tell the JDK folks that, hey, can you please add bag and multimap? Okay, and I'll be happy to, you know, contribute the bag and multimap to the JDK if they want it, right? Let me go back and, like, write the test. I hope they want it. Again, essentially, it's not that easy to add anything in the JDK, okay? And all of, like, I'm not saying this out of jest or, like, joking or anything. Essentially, adding anything to the JDK is extremely difficult, because any given time you add anything to the JDK, you're essentially impacting millions of developers, right? So anytime a new API is added, anytime a new data structure is added, anything is deprecated, anything is removed, it has to be done extremely cautiously, okay? So it might be a great idea to have a bag and a multimap in a framework like Eclipse Collections. However, it might be a bit difficult to put it in the JDK. Again, we don't know. It depends on if it makes sense to add it there, or it makes sense to just keep it in all the libraries. In order to conclude, today we learned. So what did we learn today? What is Eclipse Collections? I hope everybody knows now, right? What is Eclipse Collections? Then second one is the API evolution of Eclipse Collections. Third, we went over list, set, and map. Then we implemented bag and multimap, right? To all those four, that was pretty much my presentation. If you have any more questions, I'll be happy to discuss that. Lastly, my Twitter handle is Nikhil Nanivade. Feel free to follow me. I tweet a little bit about Java, more about my travels and food. I'm an absolute foodie. So yeah, you will see that. The project website is eclipse.org/collections. This is English. If you want Spanish, it's eclipse.org/collection/es/index.html. The GitHub site is github.com/eclipse/eclipse-collections. And the GitHub repo for this talk, like everything that I developed right now, is github.com/NikhilNanivadekar/DIY-collections. Yeah, remember to spell that, by the way. With all that, thanks a lot. Gracias, muchos gracias for spending your Monday evening with me till almost 9 p.m. I'll be happy to come back again to present on something else if you all will have me. Thanks a lot. Sure, I'll be happy to answer questions. Please don't ask what is Eclipse Collections.
what about variants? I know that, you know, generics are by default are invariant.
Yes.
In Java, but since you have immutable collections, did you do anything about variants, or they're no. Just invariant collections, all of them?
No. We didn't do anything. The fact that they don't have the API available That's what makes it immutable. So what are some of our immutable collections do is they end up, the actual implementation still extends the JDK collection just for interop, but then we throw at runtime. But our actual immutable collections, we don't do anything with regards to variants. We still use the same generics, just that the API is not exposed. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Okay. I'm going to assume I did an amazing job.
He just wants me. He wants to ask something, but he's asked me to translate.
Oh, sure, sure.
Si hay algún API o alguna funcionalidad del framework que ya esté, que haya salido de Eclipse Collection y ya esté en el JDK, o si tienen pensada alguna funcionalidad que vayan a incorporar al JDK.
Okay. So he's asking if is there any functionality or any parts of this API in Eclipse Collections that has been integrated into the JDK, or are there any plans to integrate any of these into the JDK?
So not that I'm aware of that they want to integrate, not that I'm aware of that they haven't. However, again, Stuart is a pretty good, I can call him a pretty good friend. I think he calls me a pretty good friend as well. But essentially, we do end up discussing about the different APIs that are there and the different implementation that is there. For example, in BAG, like again, going back to the data structure that we implemented. So there are two APIs which are extremely difficult to do it if you were doing it with the JDK map equivalent. And the API is top occurrences and bottom occurrences. So what top occurrences mean is like, hey, give me the top five, you know, elements by occurrences. Like, let's say you have a ranking system on a dashboard or something like that. You just want to know top 10, top 5, same as bottom 5, bottom 10, right? Now in the JDK, it is extremely difficult to implement this because how do you handle ties? If the same element has occurred, like if more than one element has occurred the same number of times, how do you handle ties? It's not so straightforward in the JDK. So hopefully, in the future, a similar like, and that's the reason why, like, you cannot just add that API to map, right? It doesn't make sense, right? It makes sense on bag. It doesn't make sense on a map. So hopefully we get a bag and a multi-map in the JDK so that all of these will already be available to us. So hopefully that answers your question. Yeah. Any other questions? Wow, everybody woke up right now. Okay, thanks a lot. But happy to chat afterwards. If you have any questions, feel free to tweet at me. I'm generally on Twitter for a long time at the unhappiness of some people. But at the same time, like, it's the best way to, you know, get hold of me and like reach me. So, right, cool. Thanks a lot.